All praise be to Allah, the cherisher and sustainer of the worlds, and peace and blessings of Allah be on His last Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Recently, again, I saw the video of David Wood speaking about Nahid Hattar killed for cartoon for depicting Muslim God and depicting Muslim paradise. Now, David Wood comes forward in support of Nahid Hattar against those Muslims who say that Nahid Hattar was wrong in depicting Muslim paradise and mocking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, God Almighty. But here, Nahid Hattar, according to David Wood, is correct and appropriate, and he says that Nahid Hattar was all right because it is based on Muslim sources, it is based on Quran and Hadith. And he goes on to explain that in Surah An-Nisa chapter 4 verse number 3 speaks about the polygamy. Because Surah An-Nisa chapter 4 verse number 3 says, فَانْكِحُوا مَا تَابَ لَكُمْ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ مَثْنَى وَثُلَاثَ وَرُبَاعَ وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا فَوَاحِدَةً. That marry women of your choice in 2s, 3s and 4s, but if you can't deal with them justly, marry only one. So here the permission for polygamy is given to the Muslims. So he quotes this verse saying that Nahid Hattar was justified because Quran gives permission for polygamy. So if Nahid Hattar depicts Muslim paradise with girls, so there is no problem in that. Again in chapter 33 verse number 50, he quotes Surah Al-Azab chapter 33 verse 50, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives permission to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, special permission for marriage, that he can marry more than 4 wives, and David Wood picks up that and says that this is the basis on which Nahid Hattar is appropriate and correct and he is not wrong. Let me tell you what Nahid Hattar in a cartoon he depicts and what he shows in the cartoon. In cartoon, he makes the Muslim man sleeping with two girls, two young girls on the either side, right side and left side. And a Muslim god, an old man, saying that Muslim god with a crown on his head, having 666 mark, and speaking to this person, Muslim person, and they are having conversation. So he says that because chapter 33 verse 50 speaks about marriage, allowing Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam marrying more than one wife, and chapter 4 verse number 3 speaks about marrying more than one wife, up to 4 wives to a Muslim man, so this is okay. Now the cartoon does not depict polygamy there. Cartoon is depicting two girls sleeping side by side on the right side and the left side. This is absolutely against Islam. Even if you are married to two wives, you are not supposed to sleep with two wives together at one bed. It is absolutely wrong. It is against Islam. So to say that it is according to Islam, it is absolutely false and wrong. And Nahid Hattar is absolutely wrong and he deserves punishment for that. Again, cartoon shows God in a human form, old person, God, you know, you Christian, you believe God, Jesus as a young person and you make Muslim God as an old person and you make Muslim God, old man, speaking as a God having 666. Again, this is a blasphemy against Islam because we do not have any image of God. We cannot have any image of God. Quran clearly mentions in Surah Al-Ikhlas chapter 112 verses 1 to 4 giving the definition who God is. It says clearly, Qul huwallahu ahad, say He is Allah the one and only, Allahu samad, Allah the eternal and absolute, lam yalid wa lam yulad, He begets not nor is begotten, wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad, and there is none like unto Him. You cannot imagine anything for God. If you imagine anything as big as from sky to the heavens, it cannot be God. You cannot imagine anything as God. So how can you make Muslim God as an old person? This is absolutely wrong and against Islam, and Nahid Hattar deserves punishment. According to Islam, Nahid Hattar is against mocking Muslim God, mocking paradise. So Nahid Hattar deserves punishment. Moreover, he has a mark on 666. Why he has a 66? Because Bible speaks about the beast in the Book of Revelation numbering 666. Therefore, you are again mocking because this person, Nahi Dattar, originally he is a Christian. Though he claims that he is an atheist, but originally he is a Christian. So he has 666 mark on the forehead, on the crown of this old person, which he is depicting as Muslim God. Again, this is insinuation. This is again a blasphemy to mark beast number 666 on saying that this is a Muslim God. Absolutely. So Islam, Alhamdulillah, is against portraying any image of God. So it is absolutely against Islam. So to say that this is based on Muslim sources, it is based on Quran and Hadith, it is absolutely wrong, David Wood. You are also wrong in that saying that it is based on Muslim sources. This is not based on Muslim sources. Islam does not allow to sleep with two women even if you are married to two wives, you are not allowed to sleep with two wives together and on one bed. You cannot make an image of God like a human being. You cannot, because Quran clearly says, "Walam yakullahu kufuwan ahad," there is none like him. Again, speak about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he was having nine wives and he used to visit nine of them in one night, and insinuating and charging, blaming him and charging him that he had sex with all nine wives in one night. This is absolutely wrong. Again, you quote the hadith number 5215 in Sahih Bukhari, where narrator Anas bin Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, peace be upon him, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to pass by all his wives in one night, and at that time he had nine wives. So he passed all the nine wives in one night doesn't mean that he had sex with all the nine wives in one night. It doesn't mean so. Does the hadith say that he had sex with all the nine wives in one night? It doesn't mention sex. So just the hadith says that he passed all the nine wives in one night, meaning that he visited all of them, taking care of them, finding out if there is any problem. So this was just a visit, casual visit of all the, and it was a hobby of Prophet Muhammad to visit all the wives in a row. So to say that in one night he had sex with all the wives, this is absolutely wrong, because in the hadith it is very much established that Prophet Muhammad had fixed days to all the wives. It was in turn that he used to go to all his wives, not in one day, not in one night. Again, you quote the hadith from Sahih Bukhari, hadith number 268, narrated Qatada radiallahu ta'ala anha, Anas bin Malik said, the Prophet used to visit all his wives in round during the day and night. During the day and night clearly indicates that this is not for sex. In daytime, you do not have sex with wives. During day and night clearly indicates that it was just to see you, how they are, to know about them, just to visit them. And he says, I asked Anas, had the Prophet had strength for it? And Qatada asked Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, had the Prophet had strength for it? And Anas replied, we used to say that the Prophet was given the strength of 30 men. We used to say that Prophet was given the strength of 30 men. This particular statement is not at the time when he is mentioning that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam visited all the nine wives. He did not at that time. This particular, if you do little study of Islam, if you had asked the scholars of Muslim scholars about this particular hadith, who know about this hadith, and if you visit the Fathul Bari, you will come to know that these hadiths are at different occasions. Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu himself says that we used to say that Prophet Muhammad had the strength of 30 men. 30 men's strength doesn't mean that he had a strength for 30 women. No, it doesn't say so. 30, he had a, definitely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, God Almighty, if he wants to give the strength of 30 men, he can give 30 men. If God Almighty wants to give the strength of 100 men, he can give 100 men also. There is no problem for God. God can give the strength of 30 men. And Alhamdulillah, we know from the biography of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Rukana Abd Yazid, he was the most famous wrestler at the time of Prophet Muhammad. He had defeated everyone. He was not defeated by anyone. And he challenged Prophet Muhammad that if you wrestle me and if you defeat me, I will accept Islam. And Alhamdulillah, Prophet Muhammad readily agreed. He was not that strong compared to when you see visually, he was not that strong. But Allah gave strength more, 30 equal to 30 men, he had more strength. and alhamdulillah, he easily defeated Rukana Abde Yazid. He easily defeated him. So he had strength, alhamdulillah. At the time of Battle of Trench, when they had to dig the big trench, in that trench, Sahaba, the companions, there was a stone they could not break. One by one, they all tried, they could not break the stone. But when it was complained that they cannot break the stone, making this trench, so Prophet Muhammad came and he gave a one blow and it splattered and it broke all that stone. In three strokes, everything was finished. So he had a strength. And in one night, at the time of 2-3 o'clock in late night, he heard some commotion that someone in Medina, a group of people, they are coming to attack. He takes a sword and he jumps over his horse and he moves and goes alone just to check what is going on. And he moved there. Alhamdulillah, they see him. People, after seeing him, they ran away, they go away, and he comes back, returning back. And Sahaba, the companions, now they follow from behind and they meet Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Prophet Muhammad, they meet him, and Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, go away, go sleep, no problem. Made them go away and they are away. So Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he had more courage, more strength. There is no, if God Almighty gives more strength and more courage, what is the problem with you, David? Why you are concerned about that? It is in the hands of God. Whoever he wants to give the strength, he can give strength. It doesn't mean that he had given strength for having sex for all with all women, because having sex, having going to the wives were on the fixed days. It is established strongly. It was based on fixed days. Now, you should look into your Bible. You should, if anyone makes a cartoon, Muslims will not make any cartoon of Lut alayhi salam sleeping with two daughters, which is mentioned in Genesis chapter 19, verse number 30 to 36, where one night the elder daughter, she gives wine to Lut alayhi salam. Lut, peace be upon him. We say peace be upon him. We don't say Lut alayhi salam, but we say Lut alayhi salam, Lut, Lord. She gives wine to her one night and sleeps with her father. She says to younger daughter, younger sister, and she says that I have slept yesterday night, you sleep today, and today also they gave wine to father, Lut alayhi salam, Lut, peace be upon him, and they make him drink, and she sleeps again. And with this sleeping, they one shot, they get begotten, they have conceived, they have child in their womb, and they give birth to two different child. Moab and Ammonites. So, two children they got. So, Muslims will not have the depiction of these two daughters having sex with father. Muslims will not have that. So, if it is based, if anything is based like that, it is based on Bible. Now, you read in 1 Kings chapter 1, verses 1 to 4, where King David was old and stricken in years, and they wanted to cover him up with blankets and coverings because he was shivering. But he could not be warmed up with blankets and coverings. So they said, Master, we would like to have a beautiful virgin girl for you. We will find a beautiful virgin girl for you. And she will sing you, she will care with you, and you will be warmed with that. And they went out to all the territories of Israel, throughout the territories of Israel, they went out and found the girl by the name of Abishag from the Shunammite tribe. And she came and she lied with David, warming up David. How can a girl warm up old David on a bed? By rubbing the body. By rubbing the body, you get warmer. Now, are you going to make a cartoon of David and rubbing of body of any girl, beautiful virgin girl? Muslim will not allow you. Muslim will not allow you. But you can very well have it. Nahidatar depiction is based on these scriptures. These scriptures, 1 Kings chapter 1, verses 1 to 4. Now, you say about 9 wives one night, whereas I have already explained that this is not regarding 9 wives, but you have to see your Bible in 2 Samuel chapter 16, verse number 22. In 2 Samuel chapter 16, verse number 22, is where David, son of David, he sleeps with 10 of his concubines, 10 of his, the concubines of his father, David, in one night. So you should have the cartoon, if you want, of David's son having sex with his mother's concubine of his father, in one night on the terrace. So you can have that as the cartoon for you. Islam does not speak about having sex with nine wives or 10 wives, nothing like that. So this is, Nahid Attar was wrong in making that cartoon, absolutely wrong, and he deserves punishment. Deserves punishment, I don't say that anybody can give that punishment. Anybody can take the law in his hand and punish that person. He was going through the court proceedings, that was okay, and court was supposed to decide what punishment should be given to that person. So court has to decide, not that person. That person was wrong who shot him dead. That person was absolutely wrong. He cannot take law in his hand. It was the court who was supposed to give that punishment and give that verdict. So I am against killing of Nahid Attar, but he deserves punishment because he mocked Muslim God and he mocked Muslim paradise. So absolutely he deserves punishment. Whatever punishment, that court will decide. You again speak about that Prophet Muhammad, he married his adopted son's wife, Zainab Razila Talana, and you give the fabricated story, false story about Prophet Muhammad seeing Zainab Razila Talana in little clothing, and she seeing the beauty of Zainab, he got attracted. And therefore he made Zaid to divorce Zainab, and so that he could marry. This is absolutely made up story. This is not established in authentic Sunnah. It is absolutely wrong that Prophet Muhammad he peeped into seeing, because it is against Islam. His teaching is to lower gaze and guard your modesty. In Surah An-Nisa, Surah An-Nur, chapter 24, verse number 30 and 31, speaking to men and speaking to the women, that you should lower your gaze and guard your modesty. This is the teaching of the Quran. How can he go himself against the teaching of the Quran, when we know that he was the walking Quran, talking Quran? He absolutely 100% followed the Quran. So this is absolutely wrong on your part to say that Prophet Muhammad looked at the Zainab Razila Ta'ala Anha, Zainab, that she was in a little clothing, and because of that he got attracted. This is absolutely wrong. This is not established in the authentic narration of the hadith of our Prophet. You will not find this. This is absolutely wrong. Yes, he had to marry Zainab, the wife of Zaid Razila Ta'ala Anha, the adopted son of Prophet Muhammad, adopted initially in the beginning. Later on, that was abolished. There is nothing like adoption in Islam. You cannot adopt a child and give your name. This is against Islam, and Quran prohibits that. Islam prohibits that you cannot adopt a child and give your name. You cannot give your name. It was wrong on his part, on Prophet Muhammad initially, when he was instructed that it is wrong. So he then stopped saying that he is the adopted son. But Prophet Muhammad was instrumental in marrying Zainab with Zaid Razila Ta'ala. He was instrumental because he was taking care of Zaid Razila Ta'ala. Now Zaid Razila Ta'ala was a slave person. Zainab was from a higher lineage, respected lineage. So Prophet Muhammad wanted to break that barrier of high and low, and he made Zainab Razila Ta'ala to marry Zaid Razila Ta'ala. Zainab with Zaid, he was instrumental in marrying both of them. So why he would want Zaid to divorce Zainab? He did not want to divorce Zainab. Zaid Razila Ta'ala, because of his low status and Zainab high status, they could not go along together as a husband and wife, and it was difficult, and they were not compatible, and they had to divorce. And Prophet Muhammad wanted and asked Zaid to continue with the marriage, but when it was not possible, it was the turn that Prophet Muhammad should marry, and it was from Allah who made who asked Prophet Muhammad to marry. This was again to break another rule of the society. Another rule of the society, because in the society it was established that you cannot marry the wife of your adopted son. You cannot marry the wife of your adopted son. Now, adopted son, this was established. Now, Quran comes and gives a rule, new ruling, that there is nothing like adopted son. So now you can marry. So you have to break that rule which is established, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to break that rule which is established. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his heart, he hated that. He didn't want to do that because people will call him names with him, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had desire not to marry with Zainab. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes forward and say that how can you fear other people and not fear God? You are not supposed to fear anyone else. You have to do what I command you. So it is the commandment of God to marry Zainab to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded by God, and his marriage took place. The marriage was solemnized by God Almighty of Zainab radhiyallahu ta'ala anha with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So again, this is absolutely wrong. So it is wrong to say that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam purposely married Zainab radhiyallahu ta'ala anha. So the story, you have to find out the correct narration, correct story, not a spurious one, not a fabricated one, not a false story. Now, you also speak about Maria Qibtiyah, that he, alhamdulillah, he had sex with Maria Qibtiyah. She was presented by Egyptian ruler, and she was given as a gift. So you cannot reject the gift. Once you are given a gift, you have to accept. And Allah, God Almighty, gives that permission to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Who are we to object Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam if God Almighty gives that permission to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Your problem, David, is that you don't believe Quran as the word of God. Because you don't believe Quran as the word of God, so everything is a problem for you. We Muslims, we believe that Quran is the word of God. So whatever Quran says, we say this is from God Almighty, and we have no problem. Because whatever God says, God is the final authority. If he allows Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to marry more than four wives, he can marry four wives, he can marry nine wives, he can marry 13 wives. Whatever God can allow, he can marry that much wife. Alhamdulillah, God Almighty also speaks about the Quran that after this, you are not permitted to marry more wives. Even restriction is given to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also in the Quran that you are not allowed to marry after this. So this is again the problem. Let me tell you, the problem of yours is that you don't believe Quran is the word of God. Therefore, you have all these problems. We Muslims, we believe that Quran is the word of God. Therefore, we don't have any problem. Now, we speak about that Aisha, Hafsa and Aisha used to not leave Maria, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam took an oath that he will not have sex. Again, this was wrong, that Prophet Muhammad took oath that he did not have sex, because if he was allowed to have sex, why he should take oath? So God Almighty comes forward and says that how can you make halal and haram on your basis? Or how can you make halal things haram? How can you make permitted things prohibited and prohibited things permitted? This is there in chapter 66, verse number 1 and 2. But this particular ayah, this particular verse is regarding the honey part, the story of honey which he used to have with one wife, and because of the bad breath, other wives they complained about the bad breath. Therefore, he promised and he took oath that he will not have the honey henceforth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in that context, he says to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how can you make halal things haram? In that context, for the honey. Now that particular statement had become general, and it can be utilized for this also, that how can you prohibit yourself what is permitted? How can you prohibit sex? If sex in the Maria Qibtiyah is permitted, how can you prohibit that? It is applicable there also. So it's not a problem. So it is the permission from God. So we cannot take objection to what God says. So God has the final authority. He can speak, he can permit anyone what he wants. Then you will jump on that if this is, he was a sex addict. How can he be a sex addict? Prophet Muhammad, when he was 25 years old, he married 40 years old woman, Khadija Radhiyallahu Anha. When he had to marry another wife, he had to marry only after 50 years of age. If he was a sex addict, he should have married more and more wives when he was 20 years old, when he was 25 years old, at that time when his youth was prime, when he was in his prime youth, then at that time he should have married if he was a sex addict. All the marriage, you have to go in the history of marriage, why he had to marry different wives, why he had to marry more than one wife. This was for different political, social purpose. The purpose was absolutely different. So you have to look into that. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows that, marrying is not a pleasure like that. One marriage is a headache. Two marriage is double headache. Three marriage is triple headache. It is not a It is not that everything is luxury. You have to take the responsibility of the wife. So, to say that Prophet Muhammad is sex addict, it is absolutely wrong on your part. Prophet, alhamdulillah, obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what Allah, God Almighty, asked him to do. He did the same thing what Allah, God Almighty, asked to do. He did not go against God Almighty. Now you speak about if the person like Muhammad, if he explains about paradise in the heaven, how can that paradise will be? And you go away and you pick up those verses which speaks about pool, women of paradise. In chapter 44, verse number 51 to 54, we will marry them to fair women with large beautiful eyes. You have objection to this particular verse. Chapter 44, verse number 54. Chapter 44, verse number 54, we will marry them to fair women with large, beautiful eyes. What is the problem with you that God Almighty is saying that we will marry you in the heavens with large, beautiful eyes? What is the problem in that? You want to have, you want a wife with a small little eyes? You want a wife, an ugly wife for yourself? You don't want ugly wife here in this world. Why you would like to have ugly wife in the hereafter in this paradise? What problem you have with this? You quote Suratul Rahman chapter 55, verse number 54, 56. In them a woman limiting their glances untouched before them by men and jinn. Untouched, they are women untouched before by any men and jinn. So this is good. You are in paradise. You are getting women who are not touched by men, who are not touched by jinn. It is good. Why it is a problem with you? You want a woman with touch with jinn and woman, with jinn and men? Do you want that woman in this world? You have no problem here. It's your problem. But you, alhamdulillah, you cannot take objection to this particular statement that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they are not touched, the woman you are given in paradise, they are not touched with men and jinn. No men and jinn have touched them. Then he goes to Suratul Rahman chapter 55, verse number 70 to 74. In them are good and beautiful women. What is the problem in that? In them are good and beautiful women. So, if in paradise you will get good and beautiful women, what is the problem in that? In paradise, you are not going to play guitar, you are not going to sit idle, you are enjoying life in paradise. You are, one day will be equal to 50 years of this life. 50 years of this life. In 50 years period of one day, you will just sitting there doing nothing. God provides you luxuries, God provides you wives and women. It is good, it is better. So how can you take objection to that? I don't know what's problem with you. As if you don't have sex, born without your father and mother having sex, is it sinful? So how can you have take objection to that? In Suratul Waqia chapter 56, verse number 35 to 38, you speak, you take objection to this also. We have produced the women of paradise, a new creation, made them virgins. And we have produced in paradise a new creation, woman, and made them virgin. Again, there is no problem in that. If you have provided a virgin woman in paradise, why you are objecting to that, a virgin woman? Why you want a woman who are rubbish? You should have a good woman. If God Almighty is providing you a virgin woman, what's the problem in that? I don't know what's the problem with you. I really don't know. In Surah An-Naba, chapter 78, verse number 31, 34, speaks about you will be provided with a woman with swelling breast, companions of equal age. Again, this is not a problem, speaking about a woman who is young and who is equal age. Allah will provide such a woman to you. So you should avoid having sex with extramarital sex, wives and girls and girlfriends in this life. If you avoid that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will compensate that in the hereafter, and you will provide it with good, beautiful, luxurious and lustrous and beautiful, large eyes woman in the paradise. You will be provided with that. So we believe that Allah, God Almighty, will be providing luxuries in paradise. So there is no problem in that. So you say that this is something objectionable. I don't find any objectionable in that. Then you quote that jihadis will be given 72 whos. Yes, jihadi will be given 72 whos. What's the problem in you with you then? If jihadis are given 72 whos, let them be given. So as you quote in Tafsir Ibn Kathir, quoting chapter 56, verse 35-37, men in paradise will have power to have sex with 100 women, 100 whos. So if they are given the power of having sex with 100 women, if they are giving 72, it's okay. What's the problem in that? If 72 is given and they are giving the power of 100, so absolutely okay. So if jihadis are giving 72 rules, absolutely okay. There's no problem in that. Jalalain, you quote chapter 36, verse number 55, that delighting pleasures, of course you will have a delighting pleasure. There's no objection in that. Why you should take objection for delighting in pleasures in the heavens? In Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 56, verse number 36, every time they will become virgin. Jalalain, Tafsir Jalalain, you quote saying that every time they will become virgin. So it is good again, every time they will become virgin. Why you want a rubbish one? If every time they will become virgin, it is good. So paradise is a place to enjoy, not to flog there. You have to flog here, you have to work righteousness here, you have to struggle here, you have to strive here. In the paradise, you will be rewarded, and paradise will be a luxurious place. It is a place of bliss. Don't expect hell in paradise. If you want to go to hell, it is up to you. You go to hell. No problem in that. But if we want to go into paradise, we want to enjoy. So leave that paradise for us. We will be agree with that paradise. And you are wrong again, saying that Muslims will say we deny such paradise. No Muslims deny such paradise. We Muslims accept the Quran, and we Muslims do not deny a paradise mentioned in the Quran. So you are wrong when you say that Muslims deny paradise, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is better you because you are better than Muhammad. You are not better than Muhammad. Muhammad is the best. Nobody can be better than Muhammad. Quran mentions about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Surah Al-Qalam, chapter 68, verse number 4. Inna ka la'ala khuluqin azim. You stand it on the highest pinnacle of character. The hadith of the Prophet says, Innama bu'istu liyutimma makarim al-akhlaq. I am sent, and the purpose of me sending in this world is to perfect the character, to make character perfect. So he was the best in character, best person. We cannot be close to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So to say that you are more better than the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and because we reject such paradise, no, we do not reject such paradise. We accept all what is mentioned in the Quran and whatever I have mentioned. We accept all the paradise, all the Muslims accept. No Muslims reject such paradise. So to say that Muslims reject, you are absolutely wrong. You are absolutely wrong. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, finally you say that if you probably you need a new prophet, probably we don't need any prophet. And it is not what we need and what you need. It is not upon our need. It is the declaration from God that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last prophet. And with this I conclude with the verse in chapter 33, verse number 40. Ma kana Muhammadun aba ahdi miljalikum walaki rasulallah wa khataman nabiyin. That Muhammad is not the father of any of men, but he is the messenger of Allah and he is the seal of all the prophets. is the messenger of Allah and is the last prophet. After Prophet Muhammad, there is no prophet after him. So you don't need any prophet, and Allah has declared that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he is the last prophet, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is the last prophet. With this I conclude. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا أَنِ الْحَمْدِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.